So in this segment, we're going to be talking about... We've got quite a few articles from the Telegraph, actually. This one is, time is running out to prove Brexit is not a historic failure. So this is from Ben Marlow, the Telegraph chief city commentator. So this is a guy who would typically look at the finances in the City of London by the looks of it. And do you know what? He might be one of the few people in the Telegraph that work for the Telegraph or have written articles for them who actually understand geography. Crazy. Absolutely insane, right? Quite a long piece, so we'll just go through it how we normally do it, which is, the Prime Minister had an inspiring message for everyone on New Year's Eve. Get vaccinated to help stop the spread of the Omicron, I'm going to call it that because it sounds like Unicron variant. It should be everyone's resolution for 2022, he said, although with 82.5% of those aged 12 and over double jabbed and 59.3% already topped up with a booster, it was not a rallying cry to divide the nation in take back control style. I mean, 82.5% of people above the age of 12 being double vaccinated, that seems pretty decent. You should if you haven't, but I'm no medical expert, so talk with your doctor if you have health issues. Anyways, still, in the spirit of telling others what to do, here's a New Year's pledge for Boris Johnson. Prove to the people of this country, both Brexiteers and Remainers, that Brexit isn't destined to become a historic failure. Prove it. How is he going to prove it? Because he can't. It is a historic failure. We're having problems at the port already. That's a separate article which we're going to talk about. But, you know, prove it how. You know, that's the question that these Brexiteers keep saying, you know, prove to us that it's not a failure. You know, start doing deregulation and moving away from the onerous bureaucracy of Brussels. You know, why don't they cut VAT of energy to 0%? It's at 5%. It's not going to make that much of a difference. Stuff like that. You know, this is what they keep banging on about. It's been 5 long years since the shock referendum result. It is fairly close, I think, in the opinion polls as the polling closed. And 12 full months since Britain burst free from the shackles of Brussels. You know, it's been 12 full months, so surely we should have seen results by now, no? Should have seen something happen, no? Yeah, even some of the most ardent Brexiteers are beginning to reluctantly concede that life outside the EU is yet to live up to its billing. I mean, I could have told you that. I think most people could have... Well, not most people, but 48% of people could have told you that. Lord Frost's resignation from the cabinet last month partly expressed that disappointment. I mean, but didn't Frost leave the cabinet for other reasons, not Brexit reasons? That's what he said, right? Unless you're saying Lord Frost didn't actually tell the truth. The government too seems to have tacitly acknowledged such frustrations with a press release to mark the end of 2021 that promised to build on Brexit achievements in 2022. Okay, what Brexit achievements did we get last year? We got a deal, or two deals in principle, with Australia and New Zealand that at best case scenario add 0.01% to our GDP and worst case scenario minus 0.01% to our GDP. And in a separate video, we're going to be talking about the environmental consequences of the Brexit, of the Australia deal on the UK. You've got the UK now saying we're going to give farmers subsidies to not farm the land anymore. You know, to do floodplains and other environmental stuff, like, that's crazy. So when the government talks about Brexit gains of 2021, apart from bankrupting a load of fishermen and farmers, what have they actually achieved? Where's the results, honestly? So yeah, you know, build on the Brexit achievements of 22, coming just as several trade bodies warned new customs checks would wreck imports from the bloc. And we're going to talk, that Bloomberg article is quite good, so we're going to talk about that in a separate video. With one predicting they would become more expensive, less flexible and much slower, it was comically bad timing. I mean, it is going to be all of those things, more expensive because you're going to have to do customs checks and things like that. That adds cost. Those checks come at a cost, and there's a time cost involved as well. So that's going to add more to you know, lorry drivers being offered jobs from going from the EU to the UK. Less flexible because they have to declare a day in advance that they're going to be bringing in like agri-foods, and much slower because of the delays. I mean, comically bad timing indeed. According to Number 10's missive. I don't know what that means. Among the key successes so far is taking back control of our borders, a boast not yet necessarily supported by the record number of channel crossings in 2021 when arrivals tripled to more than 28,000. The exodus of legal migrant EU workers that have left some industries facing a workforce crisis. I mean, hospitality, is facing an absolute crisis. I think manufacturing, to an extent, is facing an absolute crisis. Basically, across the supply chain, a crisis across the board. And if you look at channel crossings, you know, they've trebled, essentially. You know, they were very high. This the whole year, 2021, look at that. Extremely high. Why? Because we can't send people back now, because we're out of the Dublin 3 agreement. So what that means is people who come here, their applications have to be processed here. Priti Patel going to be much mad about that, I'm sure. Still, if nothing else, surely we can agree that when it comes to axing red tape, the return of the crown stamp on the onto the side of the pint glass counts as a significant victory over those pesky Brussels bureaucrats, ditto removing the ban on selling in pounds and ounces. It's pretty weak stuff from the Downing Street spinners. Even the Telegraph, right? Even the Telegraph are calling out Boris Johnson's team on their weak spin, adding a stamp onto a glass. Wow, you know, that's really going to pay the bills. Going back to pounds and ounces, like, who cares? Who cares? Honestly. Honestly, who cares? Like, pounds, ounces, grams. I prefer grams because I've grown up under the metric system. You know, I know what 1 kg is. Do I know what an ounce or a pound is? No. Looks like I'm going to have to learn, though. It's pretty weak stuff from the Downing Street spinners. Perhaps all those parties are catching up with them. Funny. Funny. Mr. Funny Man. What has happened to all the big free trade deals that we were promised? In their search of benefits, officials are scraping the bottom of the barrel with such fury they have tunneled through to the antipodes, which means like the opposite side of the planet. Like the exact opposite side, which again, you know, big words, Mr. Telegraph man. The Prime Minister can talk all he likes about the landmark deals, but by the government's own admission, neither will move the dial when it comes to GDP or cheaper goods. That's something we spoke about a minute ago. The pacts are supposed to pave the way for Britain's entry to the £9 trillion comprehensive and progressive agreement for the Trans-Pacific Partnership, whose members include major economies such as Canada, Japan and Mexico, but membership of this big club remains aspirational for now, and there are serious questions about the overall benefits to exports given the physical distance between the UK and the Pacific region. And let's not forget, the British government keep telling businesses to look at emerging markets, you know, the Indo-Pacific, you know, that kind of area, India, Bangladesh, those sorts of countries around there. And there's not much, you know, you're not going to increase a ton of trade through there, not, you know, physical goods, because it's so far away. It costs money to transport those goods. And yes, these countries are having a growing middle class, but their middle class would still be probably somewhere near as wealthy as our working class. They won't be able to spend £4 and £5 on cheese every week. You know, it's going to be a big luxury for them. And even then, you know, they have their own products they're happy with. So, you know, British goods are going to be a luxury. And, you know, this man, you know, this person who wrote this article actually understands geography. It's crazy. You know, they keep talking about emerging markets like they're very, very far away. Latin America is very far away from the UK. To get to a country like Bangladesh, I think it's like almost, a 12, 14, 15 hour flight. It's crazy. And a stop off in the Middle East. So yeah, I mean, finally, someone understands geography. Madness. It's also been pointed out that the UK may be required to make kinds of compromises that Brexit is persistently cited as one of the main reasons for leaving the EU. Shock! You have to make compromises in places to get trade deals. Why? Because typically it means two countries or two entities' rules converging with each other. But the problem is, to get the Australia deal, we've had to deregulate some of our rules and import from a country that has worse standards than us. Only an insane country would do that, or a very poor country. Which one are we? The big prize remained an agreement with the Americans. I mean, that's not going to happen. And I've covered, depending on how the scheduling works, Penny Mordaunt's insane attempt to appeal to individual US states. What bizarre lady she is. But yeah, that's not going to happen. A transatlantic tie-up remains as far beyond our reach as ever. The unfortunate reality, anyway, is that for all the political hot air that they generate, most free trade deals have little impact, owing to their limited scope, because typically they just involve goods, and there are still customs checks and declarations to go through. Yes, you might get rid of tariffs, which are the main problem, but you still have rules of origins, customs, and lots of other paperwork you have to go through in order to get, you know, the tariff reduction. So yeah, this is actually turning out to be a decent article so far. If you look at the UK in terms of UK exports have recovered from Brexit, but Britain have missed out on a global trade boom. Gee, I wonder why. Let's have a look at that. Look, trade's doing well here. That's all the exports that, you know, EU countries are making, or imports EU countries are making, because of the impending checks at the start of last year. And then, look, boom, goes down. All the other countries, you've got, look, Denmark, France, the US, Japan, Italy, Canada, all booming, and we're not. You know, we're having a massive supply chain crisis, and with impending import checks, it's going to make it far worse. But it's not just that the benefits of Brexit have so far proved elusive. Good luck finding them. It's worse than that. The initial impact from chaos with customs checks and a heavy blow to business investment has been almost overwhelmingly negative, and things could get a lot worse, which is true. You know, exports have been hit fairly badly. Exports to the EU, I mean. And it's only going to get worse because these companies aren't going to bother with all this paperwork. They're going to look for alternative suppliers. Goods coming into Britain face a fresh avalanche of paperwork, threatening more supply chain dislocation and to overwhelm our ports. And the thing is, the UK will struggle to find alternative places to supply our goods from, because the EU have what, or say France would have what, 25? No, more than 25 other countries to look at in terms of getting goods in. The UK don't have that luxury. The Northern Ireland conundrum, which stumped Frost and failed to merit a mention in Prime Minister's New Year message, gee, I wonder why, has been handed to Liz Truss, whose recent ascendancy is better evidence of the government's weakness rather than her strengths. They're saying, you know, the government are so desperate, they had to put her in the role, which is interesting, because the Telegraph look like they're back in Liz Truss, or actually not Telegraph, the Daily Mail look like they're back in Liz Truss for the job. So again, you know, it's clear the Telegraph aren't the biggest fan of her, maybe because she's more Boris Johnson 2.0, and the Telegraph would rather have Dishy Rishi. Food prices could spiral further after a new year in which inflation has hit 5.2% by the end of November. And I think from what we've heard, it could be at 6-7%. Crazy numbers. For the time being, the government still has the electorate on its side, but only just perhaps. I mean, the government really doesn't have the electorate on its side if you look at the opinion polls. While a recent Ipsos Mori poll found just 24% of the population favoured rejoining the EU, I think Phil did a video debunking this poll. Results of a separate opinion survey showed that 42% of people who voted Leave in 2016 had a negative view of how Brexit has turned out so far, and it's only going to get worse. Voters aren't mugs. You can believe that if you want, power. I choose to believe the opposite. Ministers can't keep dismissing the downsides of as teething problems. How long do teething problems last? How long do you think, you know, honestly, comment it. How long can you justifiably say teething problems can last? A year, maybe at most. After that, you know, they're no longer teething problems. You know, how long do teething problems last for, like babies or toddlers? Like months, maybe at most. Nor will the public continue to accept the jam tomorrow version of events. When Boris says the government will go further and faster in 2022 to maximise the opportunities of Brexit, he should be held to it. And how is he going to do this? Like, which other countries is he going to get deals with? Not many. Yet this is the year when reality should finally match all the hype. Otherwise, even the most staunch Brexiteers may be forced to question whether they will get what they wanted. And the truth is, they're not, because they promised different things. Daniel Hannan said only a madman would... Oh, was it Daniel Hannan? Said absolutely no one is threatening our place in the single market. I think it was Owen Paterson who said only a madman would leave the single market. Well, I guess the government are run by madmen then, and mad women, because that's what we did. But yeah, you know, clearly the Telegraph aren't, or certain members of the Telegraph aren't really happy with the current trajectory of Brexit, and they're saying, you know, he's got this year really to turn it around, and he's not going to be able to do it. So anyways, look, I'm going to leave it there. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Like, comment, share, subscribe, and hopefully I'll see you in the next one.